moment to go over the last song of our service this morning because it will be a little new. We haven't done it before, but it's very fitting for today, and it's called Only King Forever. So this will also give you the opportunity to practice waving your palms because that takes a lot of practice to do that. Whenever we sing music in this service, I would invite you to raise your palm at any moment of this time. So right now I'd like to go over the chorus of You Are the Only King Forever. So repeat after me. It sounds like this. You are the only king forever.
You are the only king forever.
Mighty God, we lift you higher. And then we'll sing that all again. You are the only king forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only king forever. Let's sing it one more time. You are victorious. You are the only king forever. The first verse as well. I think it's pretty easy. You can catch on once you hear the first line.
I've got a firm foundation. A rock, the only solid ground. The nations rise and fall.
Kingdoms once strong.
Kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in
up, you all will have a great opportunity to help lead others in worship as well.
Man, thank you to our band this morning. Welcome to Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church as we worship together today on Palm Sunday in New Heights. I'm so glad that you're here. I'm Reverend Betsy Singleton Snyder, Pastor of Preaching and Missions, and we are so thankful for this Palm Sunday. It's one of my favorites in the church calendar, and I was telling the band earlier, I was baptized on Palm Sunday, and three of my four boys, my triplets, were baptized 8 years ago today on Palm Sunday. So it's a very meaningful celebration for me. I'm glad that you're here. I want to welcome those who may be visiting this morning. I want to invite everyone to please take your worship bulletin, if you would, and tear off your registration connect card on the end. Make note of the many opportunities that we have. Fill out your Connect card, your registration attendance, but also make note of what you want to participate in terms of ministries and missions coming up, and those are highlighted in your worship bulletin. Our current sermon series has been Witnesses, and today we're going to be talking about the two criminals who were among those crucified the day of Jesus' death. So we hope that in this last glimpse, of following through the witnesses to Jesus' death, that you will have enjoyed that. And next Sunday, of course, will be Easter Sunday, and we hope to see you back then and during the week. But let us stand, brothers and sisters, as we are able, as Reverend Hampton leads us in our call to worship.
Okay, let us all raise our palm branches. If you don't have one, someone will bring you one. Hosanna.
Hosanna.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of God.
Blessed are we, for we have been created by that same God.
Blessed is the sound of our voices lifted up in praise. Blessed are the hands that clap and strum and pluck, joining together in one glorious hosanna. Blessed are the bodies that move and wave and march and dance in a tapestry of motion, embodying your love. Blessed is the breath that enlivens us, animates us, and sustains us in singing our ceaseless praise to you, O God. Hosanna!
Hosanna!
Please pass the peace of Christ with one another. Thank you. At this time, I invite the children to join me on the steps for the lesson for young Christians. And bring your palm branches with you on Palm Sunday. Well, thank you all for coming forward. And there's a little basket here if you would like to put some offering in the basket. That would be fine, too. Well, what is this Sunday called? Palm Sunday. Well, do you all know that Palm Sunday is one of the most emotional Sundays? It is the most emotional Sunday in the Christian church. And this Sunday marks the beginning of a very emotional week for Christian people, because today we're celebrating our Lord and Jesus entering into Jerusalem almost 2,000 years ago as the Savior of the world. But you know, grown people, if you watched us this morning, you would think it was just another day. Did you see me waving? I was trying to wave, trying to be polite. Did you see me trying to wave? It's kind of hard, but it's really an emotional day. This is supposed to be a big celebration, and you all know how to do it, because in just a little while, you all are going to have a special donkey outside, and you all are going to really do it. But we're going to practice right now. We're going to have a real Palm Sunday right now, okay? Stand up. We're going to march. Who wants to be Jesus? Ooh, no volunteers. You volunteered. Okay, you're going to be Jesus. Okay, well, we're going to pretend you're on a donkey, and you're going to lead us straight down the center aisle. We're going to come back this way, and everybody is going to have to say what I say, and they're going to have to say it as loud as they can, and we're going to keep on walking all morning. We want to hear some noise, okay? Okay, let's start out. Let's go. Everybody get your palm branches out now. Let the kid come out in you. Hosanna! Oh, it's too weak. Hosanna! Blessed is the name of the Lord. Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed is the name of the Lord. Now, let's turn this way. Now, you know, they did a lot better, but now we're going to really bring the kid out of them. They have to stand up. Some of them are saying, oh, my goodness. Stand up now. We got to say it. Now, you get to shout as loud as you want to, adults. Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Last time, now reach down deep. Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. All right, now I think we're in the spirit of Palm Sunday now. Say praise the Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you, boys and girls. Let us pray. Gracious God, thank you for this Sunday as we remember our Lord Jesus entering into Jerusalem. Be with us this week as we follow Jesus and as we remember his life, death, and resurrection. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you, boys and girls.
On earth were considered criminals and had been sentenced to death just like he was. We believe Jesus was innocent. We may wonder about the other men. Please stand as you're able for the reading from Luke 23, 32 through 33 and 39 through 43. They also led two other criminals to be executed with Jesus. And when they arrived at the place called the Skull, they crucified him, along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. One of the criminals hanging next to Jesus insulted him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." Responding, the other criminal spoke harshly to him. "Don't you fear God, seeing that you've also been sentenced to die? We are rightly condemned, for we are receiving the appropriate sentence for what we did. But this man has done no wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus replied, I assure you that today you will be with me in paradise. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
If you would join with me in a spirit of prayer. Gracious God, either through me or in spite of me, speak your good news that all of us on this Palm Sunday who hear it may also embrace it and most of all live it. In the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior, amen. Several years ago, Monroe Beachy, a respected financial figure in his Amish community for decades, actually, was arrested and accused by prosecutors of running a Ponzi scheme that betrayed his neighbors, not only their trust, but it also wiped out more than $16 million of their savings. Rather than rejection and rightful bitterness, the elders of the Amish faith community decided to take a different position. They decided it was more important to forgive Beachy than to recover their money. The Amish community even asked that the case move out of the secular courts and into the hands of the church. In this way, they claimed, the matter would be less expensive as a process, and it would be based on Christian principles of love and care for the poor and the needy. They believed it would also create a setting in which biblical forgiveness and restoration could be found between Beachy and those he was accused of betraying. One passage of the court document filed to move the case out of the court said, forgiving a brother does not require shielding him from his fate, but extending charity to those harmed and to those that have done the harm is our testimony to the world of love and forgiveness. The Amish community did not forget, you see, what harm had been done, but they decided, they made a choice to work toward forgiveness because they are so saturated in Jesus' ethic of forgiveness that to abandon it would be akin to giving up their horse-drawn buggies and heading off to the nearest car lot. You see my point? Forgiveness is so much a part of their community life. You know, that happened also in the case of the shooting that took place among the Amish a few later years. Thoughts about forgiveness have been especially on my mind this Lenten season, especially because we are witnessing exposure to increased violence through news of regular and global attacks on citizens. We've seen it in Sweden recently, in London. Just today, in Egypt, at a Coptic church in the Nile Delta, which killed 27, I believe, and injured at least 60 that we know of. In recent weeks, at the beginning of this month, a recent U.S.-led coalition bombing on ISIL killed over 300 civilians in Mosul, Iraq. In this past week, of course, the sarin gas that was unleashed by the Syrian dictator on innocent human lives, babies, children, adults. And right now in Arkansas, there are scheduled executions of 7 inmates on death row following Easter. A lot of violence in the world. And these that I've listed are certainly not the only acts of violence. There have been, you know, local shootings in our own city. I read this week about a 3-month-old infant abused so by his parents in unspeakable ways. And there was the woman who dropped a dog from a 5th-floor balcony when you hear this epidemic of violence, you wonder, has anyone heard of the Prince of Peace? Has anyone heard of the Prince of Peace? You know, today is Palm Sunday, the day we commemorate, and I'm so glad Reverend Hampton had us get up off of it and get it going for Jesus this morning. Those hosannas, that triumphant entry into Jerusalem, it was also a symbolic entry because unlike the Roman occupiers on their fine stallions, Jesus rode into this important city, which was a city of civil and religious power. He rode in on a donkey, on a humble animal, not known for its power and strength. Jesus was signaling not might and conquest, but the kingdom of God that is all about peace. I think that's why Jesus taught us to reorder our priorities then as now by praying, "For yours, God, is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Not any nation, not any army, no one else." We can imagine that Jesus' subversive message created not only faithful followers, but a great deal more enemies. As we follow the key events of Jesus' last week of life on earth, we know that these joyful hosannas, the words meaning save us. Hosanna means save us. Those will turn quickly to ugly threats and taunts and abuse. Peace threatens the status quo. Soon after Jesus' welcome party by the crowds and those hosannas, Luke's gospel recounts that Jesus is betrayed by one of his disciples, one of his own, and then he's abandoned by all except the women. After Jesus is arrested and put on trial, then Pilate declares him innocent, but the crowd shouts for the release, remember, of Barabbas, whom we are told is imprisoned for rioting and murder. Jesus is then sentenced to a horrible execution, and that's where our scripture reading begins. Jesus on a cross between two other criminals. Now, most of us, especially us older folks, we know this story fairly well, I think, at least somewhat. I've thought about different ways we may understand the scene before us and how it plays out. One criminal sneers at Jesus. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." The other man on the other cross has a strong rebuke to that insult. Don't you fear God, seeing that you've also been sentenced to die? We are rightly condemned, for we are receiving the appropriate sentence for what we did, but this man has done nothing wrong. You know, Luke has given us a key here. To all who are reading, this ain't fair. One way to interpret is to interpret the scene by acknowledging that even those who ask forgiveness at the ninth hour are treated as graciously and reassured of God's love as those who haven't been a part of the kingdom on earth all along. Jesus actually told a story. Remember this story? It really kind of was one of those stories that can rub on you a little bit if you've been a Christian all your life. We refer to it as the parable of the laborers in the vineyard. And it reminds me of the crucifixion scene, because in the parable, Jesus says it doesn't matter how late someone shows up to work in the vineyard, that person will still get full wages. What? That ain't fair. What? You know, I mean, doesn't that kind of chafe you a bit? Doesn't that rub you the wrong way? Does me. I have 4 kids, as y'all know by now, ad nauseum, right? And one of the biggest challenges of my everlasting mom existence is to determine what is fair. Amen. I would live to be 102 if I had a minute for every time I've heard the words, "That's not fair." It's uttered at my house before I came this morning. I heard that from three kids. And when a child utters that something is unfair, it means that that kid has determined he didn't get the same treatment. He has assumed someone else doesn't deserve the grace bestowed, the free ride given after a family infraction has been committed. We're all hung up on fairness, but I propose this morning to you that that may not be God's hang up. Right? The second notion I have about this three-way conversation is that it looks pretty clear that Jesus not only accepts latecomers, Jesus even expects them to show up. And he makes no bones about it. The man next to him, the dregs of society, the scum, the supposedly lawless man on a cross beside him has, Jesus says, already, right this moment, entered Jesus' kingdom where guilty, sinful, backstabbing, adulterous, and conniving people get in. Woo, that ain't fair. Is that fair? I want to go back a minute to that first criminal, that mean-spirited guy who is the doubter, the skeptic, the cynic, kind of like the elder brother in the prodigal story, right? The seemingly unrepentant fellow on the other cross. I'm going to throw this one out there for you. Maybe that guy is similar to Barabbas. You know, we're only reading a snippet this morning, but this goes in a long line. Luke goes to beginning to end. So I like reading through the whole thing these last few days, this last few weeks. Maybe that guy on the cross, that first sneering guy, is similar to Barabbas, the man released instead of Jesus. A number of scholars believe that Barabbas was a prisoner who was likely someone involved in resistance against Rome. Because if you read that little section, it says he'd been rioting. He was an insurrectionist, depending on the translation you're looking at. So if that is accurate, and it surely could be, given the number of nonviolent resistance movements going on and occurring under Roman occupation, then death would be the logical sentence for that criminal as well as Barabbas, who's exchanged for Jesus, you see? After all, now get this, remember this, Jesus was dragged to the Roman governor's palace for three political reasons. What were they, you remember? We found this fellow subverting the nation, opposing payment of taxes to Caesar, and saying that he himself is Christ, a king. The worst things you can do to get yourself in trouble in occupied Rome. So what then of the guy on, that first guy on that cross, might he have been one of those resistors? You see? Might he have been looking for someone to overthrow Rome and save Israel from the incredible violence that existed in an occupied state? Israel. What if that first criminal in our story, the one who insults Jesus, is actually asking to be saved? Ooh, I'm going to tell you, I've read this text many years, but I've never thought about this. What if he's asking to be saved, just as the crowds who waved their palm branches as Jesus entered Jerusalem? Think about it. You with me? I'm going to be like Bishop McKenzie. You with me? Still with me? I'll admit, now, the guy on the cross, he gives us a rude Hosanna, doesn't he? It's rude. It's not, "Oh, Hosanna, sweet sweet Jesus, save us, son of David. It's not that. It's a rude, save yourself and us. But he says it, doesn't he? Save us. He says, Hosanna. So, you know, whether you're in a leisurely crowd with your palms admiring Jesus at a distance, or you are in desperate straits on a cross next to him, most of us want some action from Jesus. We want you to do something for us, Jesus. Save us. We want some miracles to prove that you can be who you say you are to us. Save us. Hosanna. Like the tempter at the beginning of Jesus' ministry in the desert, we more often than we realize test God. Remember the words of the evil one? Since you are God's son, throw yourself down from here, for it's written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you. Maybe this criminal guy, he knows that passage of scripture the devil earlier had quoted to Jesus. You can do it. You can save us. So we might not want to sneer so much at that first guy who's shouting that rude Hosanna. Throughout his ministry, Jesus makes clear that his kingdom, however, is one of love and peace and nonviolence, and it's a view, frankly, that gets you in trouble in a violent world. But rather than give in to the world's violence, Jesus just keeps forgiving. Father, forgive them, he says between the two criminals, for they, and I'm going to add, and all who perpetuate violence, know not what they do. You see, every time we take the path of anger and fighting and violence, we often do not realize that we are diminishing our witness to the God of love and the Prince of Peace. There is a choice between these two criminals. Our choice. Who is Jesus for us? Violence or nonviolence? Elias Shakur, a Palestinian priest, was assigned to serve a small parish in the village of Israel in 1965. Okay, think back, some of you, 65, not exactly an easy time. The village was made up mostly of Arab Israelis, and both Muslims and Palestinian Christians. Shakur soon began preaching about the importance of interfaith cooperation when he received a note from his parishioners that encouraged him first to begin to reconcile brothers, sisters, and families together. The priest was stung by the truth of those words. In his book, We Belong to the Land, Shakur writes that he felt burdened because he could see so many people who had been at odds with each other for years. Every time he turned around to bless the congregation, to give them Christ's peace, as we celebrated earlier in the service, he was reminded all over again that there was, in reality, no peace among these people. Such peace had always been refused. And then, on Palm Sunday, 1966, with the church overflowing, Shakur defied normal practice, and he walked down the center aisle to the back of the church. He locked the only two doors to the church, and he took the key. And he then marched back up the aisle, and he told the people he loved them, and he was saddened by their hate and their bitterness for one another. And in the midst of stunned silence, he said, "This morning, while I celebrated the liturgy, I found someone who is able to help you. In fact, he is the only one who can work the miracle of reconciliation in this village. This person who can reconcile you is Jesus Christ. And he is here with us. We are gathered in his name. So on Christ's behalf, I say this to you. The doors of the church are locked. Either you kill each other right here, right now, in your hatred, and then I will celebrate your funerals gratis. Or you use this opportunity to be reconciled together before I open the doors of the church. If that reconciliation happens, Christ will truly become your Lord, and I will know that I am becoming your priest and your pastor. The decision is now yours. About 10 minutes passed, and no one said anything. After a while, a man stood up, a villager serving as an Israeli policeman who was in his uniform. He stretched out his arms and said, "I ask forgiveness of everybody here, and I forgive everybody. And I ask God to forgive me my sins." He and Shakur hugged with tears streaming down the man's face, and others cried, and then laughter broke out as folks who'd said such ugly words to each other, who'd not spoken in many years, were now sharing Christ's peace. Eventually, Shakur and others established a school open to all local children, regardless of their religious affiliation. In recognition of his humanitarian efforts, he has received honors that include, get this, the World Methodist Peace Award. He describes himself as a Palestinian Arab Christian Israeli. There's no division in that description. The kingdom of God is not for later. Someday. It is now. It is for today. And its primary ingredients always include repentance and forgiveness. And may we, brothers and sisters, as we get ready for Easter and walk with Jesus through this story, may we embrace his gift, the one who rides in peace and peace everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Merciful God, we praise you on this Palm Sunday morning for Jesus Christ, who entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and King by those who spread garments and branches along his way. As we remember and enter Holy Week, turn our hearts again to Jerusalem. May we one day enter in triumph the city not made by human hands, the new Jerusalem, eternal in the heavens. Touch our lives with grace through the worship we experience here today. Hear our prayers for those who have lost loved ones, to J.C. Daugherty and family in the death of his grandfather, Clyde Corbin, to the family and friends of Sarah Jane Newland in her recent death, to Billy Rutherford and family in the death of her sister, Collar Hill Borman, to Stephen Smith and Brian Smith and their families in the death of their father, Stephen Guthrie Smith, and to the family and friends of Phyllis McGrew in her recent death. We also pray for John Shermer, who was recently hospitalized, and we rejoice in the recent baptisms of Turner Adam Easley, Hayden Grace, and J. Mackey Hamilton, Braden Thomas Mitchell, and Charlotte Ann Skern. And we give thanks for Charlotte Muse and Will Fletcher and their recent marriage. And we're thankful for our new members, Christine and Stephen Creekmore, Shannon Palmer, and Tommy Hammond, Susan and Sid Wood. May your church, O God, always reach out to others who are hurting and help us to live our lives so that the world may be a better place. accept our praise and our adoration as we journey with you and your Son during this Holy Week. As we all pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As the ushers come forward to receive our offering, I'd like to remind those of you who were not able to maybe make a commitment to St. Luke, you still have time and you can complete a commitment card today. We're 90% to our goal. I think the total is over $490,000. So we hope that you will participate. Let us pray. Gracious God, receive our gifts for the building of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
every time we get ready to move forward into the week that we are not looking for more members on the rolls, but we are looking for disciples who are willing to follow Jesus through this difficult path of peacemaking and reconciliation. We would invite you to be a part of this. Our next Membership Matters is May 7th, next month. We especially want to welcome those who are visiting. I have a mug for you if you would stop by, and my number is in the worship bulletin. If you have any questions, feel free to text me. Brothers and sisters, let us sing our closing song. Here it will be at St. Luke United Methodist Church. And as we are working so hard in partnership, let me please encourage you to attend Maundy service worship at St. Luke. Let us come together with our friends as we are uniting in this wonderful mission called St. Luke Learning Center. That will be 6 p.m., as you notice, on Thursday evening there. Of course, Good Friday, we have several services, and then our Easter schedule is listed there. Dia del Niño is the Day of the Child, and we are putting that on over at St. Luke at the end of this month, and we need 25 volunteers to kind of help interact with families who show up. We've got a taco truck. We've got some wonderful stuff. It's not just for Hispanic families. It's for all children, called the Day of the Child. So we're encouraging our folks to pitch in and help out. And don't forget that our Easter egg hunt is at Alsop Park. And we have a lot of stuff going on there. Kids can bring also a snack item for our food pantry. And by the way, for those of you who have access to Snapchat, we'll have a filter up. So when you're taking your pictures, look for that filter and take some pictures and post those so we can see those. We'd love to do that. I hope that you will go out knowing that the one who saves is walking your journey. Receive this blessing. Go forth and love God and your neighbor in all that you do. Bear witness to the love of Jesus Christ so that those who do not know that love will find in each and every one of us most treasured and generous friends. In the name of Christ, amen.